Joe DeVito joins us. Hello there, Hi. Joe. Sorry to keep you waiting.
No worries.
You look...
Put my guitar down.
You look fantastic. Every time I see you, you look better and better. This Thank quarantine you. Agrees with you.
It's the virgin's blood. I can't say enough about it.
In Long Island? There are virgins in Long Island?
It's imported.
It's imported virgins. Okay.
Yeah.
How are you? How are you feeling? You look chiseled. Are you performing? Are you going out and doing the drive-in movie theaters?
I did. I did a couple of shows in parks.
You've been doing shows in parks until the Vice Squad comes and gets you.
Yeah. Well, I realized the fine line between stand-up comic and crazy street person has been erased. One of them was good. And then the other one,
Amy Cooper called in a complaint.
Yeah, right. I got Karen'd. No one even cared. No one cared to step up to the plate for that. I did two of those, and I did an outdoor show in an Italian restaurant on like a patio. And, I'd say the highlight of that was when I was on stage, I said, isn't the food here great? We wouldn't know. Usually they feed the comics. And then that got, I shamed them into feeding us.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Does comedy work outdoors during the day? Maybe at night, but during the day.
I have to tell you, the show in Central Park, it wasn't too bad. Like, I enjoyed it. I had a good time. And then the one I did in Prospect Park, I think, was not as much fun for me because it was a younger audience. And I realized just going up and saying, oh, I'm a single 51-year-old man. Like, they had no idea what any of the words in that sentence meant. So that was a little trickier.
I had a fantasy.
Yes.
Getting like a little boombox and a microphone and just traveling around the country like Woody Guthrie. And walking into cafes and saying, you want a comedy show? And just...
Like barnstorming.
Barnstorming. Just going into to bars and cafes with a hat and just doing stand-up. You want to do this with me?
Well, that's predicated on indoors and cafes being open.
And a hat.
And a hat. And hats.
So he had a hat.
Yeah, it sucks, you know, because I remember back when I first started, there was a group of guys I ran with, and the way we would get our stage time was one of us would say, hey, I found a bar somewhere that let us do a show on Friday, and we would go show up with our little amp and our microphone, and, you know, it's funny, I always used to say, you know, I miss those days, and then I meant out of nostalgia, but now I miss those days as a source of income.
Well, I think, I think we could make more money doing that, seems to me I could walk into a coffee shop. Anytime I walk into a coffee shop, I go, where's the stage? Where do you put the stage? Do you do that? You walk into a bar, where do you put?
Yeah. Yeah. I went through a phase when I was producing a lot of little shows like that, that a friend of mine actually said, stop looking around for a place to set up the stage. But every place I looked at, I thought, but we could do a show here. And he would say, that's a check cashing place. They don't need you to come in there and do a show. Yeah, I always used to think that. I'd look around and say, this was great, because comedy requires so little and is usually given so little.
And yet nobody figures it out, that when you show up to a gig, the guy hiring you, unless it's a professional comedy club, and even then, I've been amazed at how stupidly they've been designed.
Oh, yeah. I remember showing up to a gig in a restaurant bar, and when I walked in, I saw a guy in this tiny corner playing a guitar to a bunch of people drinking and ignoring him. And I thought, oh my God. And I said to the person who met me there, I said, this isn't where we're doing the show, is it? And he said, no, of course not. And he led me into a smaller, worse room.
Yeah.
So I was working the B room within that bar.
I don't understand why people don't understand how simple it is. Clear sight lines. People have to sit, well, not anymore because of COVID, but people have to sit next to each other. The chairs can't be comfortable.
Yeah, it has to be very cold. Letterman liked it freezing.
Well, yeah, but the chairs should not be comfortable. People have to sit upright and be next to each other, and don't light them. The light has to be on the stage, and it should be so dark that you can't tell who's laughing, but not so dark that somebody trips and then you can't compete with the laughs. from that. It's really quite simple, and very few people get it right.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I'm sure, again, like I said, there are gigs that I've shown up to where you look at the setup and think, who thought this was a good idea? I would like to speak to the person who thought that this was going to be a successful night of entertainment. I've shown up for gigs where they said, yeah, the comedians are going to be behind that that wall over there, and the people can still hear you, or that you're going to be up on top of a table or something like that. I remember going to one gig where everything I asked, the answer made it so much worse. I just stopped asking questions and said, I'm just going to take the hit on this one. And it was as bad. And I remember when I left, the booker texted me and said, so how was it? And I said, as I told you, it was going to be bad. And it was actually even worse than I thought it was going to be.
Worst gig in the past 2 years.
In the past 2 years.
And by definition, the worst gig is you on your way thinking it's going to be great. Right? If you know it's bad, it's never bad. It's the finding out. It's like going out on a date and discovering he or she is a psychopath.
Huh. Within the past 2 years, I know there have been a few where I came home and I was pissed off. I can tell you probably my least favorite one ever. You know, it's the strangest thing that the good feeling from a good gig dissipates so quickly, but the stink of a bad one. This was like, I'd have to say this was 8 to 10 years ago, and I still like clench my fists when I think about it. It was a men's golf outing at a country club in Jersey. And when I got there, the booker's partner, she was supposed to be helping me get set up. And I looked around, and there was really no place that made sense for the audience, which was going to be all men who were out getting plastered. They were out getting drunk at like 2 p.m. Everything was bad. And I saw they had a line of steam trays, and then there was a doorway at the end. And they said, we're going to put your microphone right in that doorway. And I said, well, there's no lighting. And they said, sorry. And I said, well, you're going to take the food. The buffet food will be gone by the time I go up. And he said, yes, but while you're up there, we're going to be replacing it with the sundae bar.
Mm.
So he said to me, so what do you think? And I said, well, it's going to be tough because of the setup, but I'm going to give it the best shot I can. And when he walked away, the booker's assistant looked at me and she said, I can't believe you said that in front of the client. I said, look, I got to get everybody's expectations adjusted here because this is going to be brutal. And she said, would it help if I got you a chair? And I said, are you implying I stand on a chair the whole time I'm doing this? And she said, oh, I'm just trying to help. And they were rude. I remember if I had done that same gig later, I just would have challenged everyone in the room to fight me. it would have been easier, which I had done at a gig once. I did that once at a gig in, I think, Williamsburg, where this was for a different reason. They were so hip. They just were really annoying. And I went up and I mentioned how usually I talk about how nerdy I look. And I looked at them and said, I think I could beat the crap out of everyone in this room here. And they laughed. I said, I'm serious. I will fight anyone in this room. And no one said anything.
Because it was a battered women's shelter.
Well, you know, I should probably read the paperwork closely before I show. No, they were very annoying. And I don't say this. I'm certainly not a tough guy, but I would rather have taken a beating than do some of these gigs. It really takes an emotional.
But if you know up front it's going to be horrible, you're fine with it.
I think you can steel your nerves a little bit.
If you're driving out,
it's coming. Yeah.
If you said to me, I got a crap gig.
Mm.
You want to drive 2 hours, and it's going to be the worst experience of your life. I go, great. Now I know what I used to do those kind of gigs. At least I knew what I was up against. But it's when it's the disappointment that something so horrible could have been good, but for the stupidity.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Those gigs where you show up and they say, oh, you needed a microphone. Like, that would have been helpful.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Angriest the audience ever got at you. I can't imagine an audience getting angry at you.
You know, I don't mind anger. I think it's when they ignore you. That's what really hurts. When you're just, I'd rather be hated than irrelevant. But I did a gig in the city once where the person who produced it wanted to have a Q&A after. And I had gotten into it with a couple of people in the crowd for being lame. I pretty much just ripped on them the whole time because they were pretty crappy. And afterward, I remember some guy in the audience said, he said, "Hey, never blame the audience." And I said, "Well, you clearly have never been a performer, because it's frequently the audience's fault." Anybody who says it's never the audience's fault has never been on stage. But, you know, it's too late by then. You just have to, you know, you just have to realize that once you go on stage, it's your problem. And then,
do you think you have too much of a work ethic? Do you think some comedians, like, have you ever, I've never, ever walked off stage. Mm-hmm. Once I did. And I've never showed up at a gig and said, I won't do this.
I bailed on a Zoom thing the other day, but I don't think that counts.
Well, it does. What happened?
It was, someone said, "Hey, it's going to be a show. It's going to be fun." And then when I logged on, the co-producer, who I thought seemed a little shaky, was saying how, "No, it's actually something we're going to try and sell, and that we're going to just wait, pause for the laughs, because there's no audience, so we're going to dub laughs in." And I said, "You know, I don't really need to do this."
Right.
And you know what the worst part is, now with the lockdown, I can't really say I have better things to do, because everyone knows that if I did, I probably did them all by April 10th. So
do you? But wait a second. I believe you do have better things to do.
I'm kidding. Yeah. But anything would be better than that. You know, elective surgery would be better than that now that they're open again. So yeah, it's
now when they
it's
say elective
thing.
Surgery. Mm-hmm. It should really be elective. Don't you think we should vote on surgery for certain people? I don't have the bit figured out yet, but I think
maybe there's something with the Electoral College factoring in there.
Yeah, there's certain, you know, maybe. Yeah.
Why does Rhode Island get to decide if I get dental implants?
So you turned it down. Did you feel guilty?
I did. Didn't feel good, because I know that the person who hooked me up with it, I didn't feel good about that. But I just messaged her and said, "Hey, I'm really sorry. This isn't what I thought it was going to be. So I'm going to have to say no." And then I dropped out.
Do you think there are certain people in our business who, you know, not physically dangerous, mm-hmm. but are dangerous to your career, that they can talk you into doing things or be working on a project with you mm-hmm. who are harmful, that they can destroy your reputation, your career, put you in a situation that you really should not be in, but they put you into it, and you have to be aware of them?
Well, that's what this thing that I passed on, her co-producer, he reminded me of, in comedy, there's a lot of people who have, I guess what you would call, harebrained schemes, and they think like, "Oh, if we just do this, we're guaranteed to have a big hit." And they focus on everything beside their lack of talent and mm-hmm. the fact that they're putting together a terrible show. So yeah, those people can be bad. I have to tell you, David, the more I look back at stand-up as a, you know, this thing that I used to do, that hopefully I'll get to do again, I'm amazed that it ever worked. It just seemed like it was asking so much. I think that's why those nights when you have those really good shows, you just feel so awesome, because it's like you think of what you pulled off. It's like going up and saying something that makes everyone sneeze at the same time. And it has nothing to do with this. Like, I think back to the, you know, that weekend that we worked at that club in Princeton. And yeah, small room, kind of a goofy setup. But we had so much fun. Mm-hmm. Just was so much fun that you and I could go up and just, like, I think we both knew which jokes we would say that would make the other one of us laugh the most. And that's where it's fun. It's just like being an idiot with your friends when you're a teenager and being inappropriate in public. It's so much entertainment value.
And then somebody hands you cash at the end of the night.
Yeah.
And it feels real. And it feels like
a pretty good racket.
Yeah. It's real money. Mm. It's, you know, I've always felt stand up comedy was real money that you earned. It was undeniable. You put the work in.
Yeah.
When do we get back to doing it? I mean, you're doing it outdoors, but
I did a few outdoors, although I heard that in Manhattan they're breaking it up. In the parks, not letting people do the shows anymore, which I don't understand what the difference is between someone speaking and people listening and someone telling jokes and an audience assembling. I don't see what the legal distinction could be, but who knows? We're living in clown world now, so I don't know why you could say one thing is legal and one thing is not legal anymore. It's just such, it's so ridiculous.
When do you see these clubs coming back, and are they going out of business?
I think a lot of them are going to go out of business. Just like, you know, there's service industry. They're restaurant bars. And what restaurant bar has a year of reserve money to sit on and can go a year with putting off rent and stuff? It's a bad situation, man. And I don't know what the answer is, but I think, you know, I think of a friend of mine who owns a private gym and they won't let him open. And he's saying, but you can go to Walmart, you can go to casinos, but you can't let me open this thing that I put my life into. It's very sad. I don't know. I really don't know what the answer is.
But would you go to a gym? Would you feel safe in a gym?
I think I would. I think I would. But it's the funny thing too, where I read the news reports and they say, you know, it really is only a concern for pre-existing conditions and older people. And I'm like, thank God. And they say, yes, men over 50. And I'm like, shit.
Right.
Now I'm in a group, you know?
Right.
But I guess it all depends on what you consider odds. When you say that the odds are below 1%, that sounds pretty good unless you're in that group.
Is there a little part of you? Mm-hmm. I mean, it's getting worse. I find myself getting, I forget that we're in the middle of a pandemic.
Yeah.
And I go, why do I feel so? But we talked about this when it started.
Yeah.
The world, certainly America, was moving towards something that had to stop for the sake of the planet and ourselves. What are you never going to do again?
Oh, well,
I'm never going to do again.
What's that?
Well, not never. I don't think I'm going to eat out the way I used to.
Yeah.
I have noticed that depending on other people to cook my food has been deleterious to my health. And
oh, okay. I get that. I think I'm going to stop paying women to cough in my face. I should have stopped that. I mean, I know it's weird, but I just felt like, you know, I couldn't ask someone I knew to do that. That was a shame. I think my experience with working the cruise ships is done. I don't see how anyone could do that. You know, it goes to show you how much things can change. I remember even talking to you about this stuff last year, thinking, hey, no matter what happens, I'll always have the cruise ships to fall back on now that I've gotten into this. And now, you know, that whole time in March when I was on that ship thinking, I just can't wait to get off this damn thing. And I made it out just in time. So, yeah, I guess we can't look at this as a dream we're in and that we're going to wake up and sort of wipe our brows and say, oh, okay, things are back to normal. It's just a different way. We're going to have a different way of interacting with each other.
Things happen very quickly. There was an article that I was reading about how all the big chains are leaving Manhattan. Mm-hmm. And I hate to see these jobs disappear. I hate to see anybody lose their work, you know. That being said, things happen very quickly. These chains disappear and nature pours a vacuum, I hope, and new things replace them. Isn't there a part of you that thinks these jobs in New York City, these retail jobs, never really paid all that much? They were unnecessary. It was all clothing and makeup and jewelry. Maybe with a little push from the government, we can see actual industry in New York where people are making something of value that we need, that these malls that are being turned over now to supermarkets, that maybe one or two libraries, a playhouse could go into these malls and we can rebuild this economy in a better way. I hate to see, believe me, we're all suffering. I hate to see this economy this way, but what are we really losing in terms of quality of life? In terms of the malls going under It was a lousy way to live.
I think we're seeing that a lot of the side effects of some of the luxury we had in our life, how non-essential things that we thought were, like, you don't need, like, fashion, for example. Fashion is something you have when you have a society that's got a lot of excess going on. You don't need a whole lot to live. Now, the question is, are people going to focus on more important things? I don't know. You know, there's a moment at the beginning of the crisis where I thought, oh, maybe we'll finally appreciate people who have the really hard jobs in our society. Maybe we'll really appreciate not just the nurses and doctors and all that, but the garbage men, the truck drivers and all that. But that didn't last because we don't want to. We don't want to appreciate people who actually work. We now we just shifted our focus to who's big on TikTok and shit like that. So we I think the saddest thing is that if we go through all this and we don't learn anything from it. And I just know in my own personal life, I am trying to learn from this, that I am very fortunate. I'm healthy. My family's healthy. I'm bored. I'm worried about the economics of it, but it's not a life or death thing for me. So I don't want to be one of these people who goes through something and at the end they haven't learned, they haven't changed. But as far as what we'll be like as a country or as a world, I can't say, because there's no way you can predict any of this stuff. I mean, look at predictions from just 4 months ago, how absurd they seem now. I mean, I even noticed that when I was going through some old social media posts, just trying to clear out some stuff. And I think, wow, I can't believe that used to matter to me, that used to be a big deal. And that is a weird thing, too, because I've noticed that when I go and watch comedy from before this, can you go back and do that material where you're complaining about waiting in line at a supermarket? You know, does the audience hear that? And do they think, oh, I'm going to shift into the magical memories of back then? Or do we only want to hear things that are in this moment right now? Right. I don't know. I don't know.
Interesting. To be continued, I hope. Are you teaching?
Yeah, I've got a few of my my one-on-one students. The classes are on hold for the moment now. But I'm doing some writing. I got some writing gigs I'm hopeful for. And you know, I've been trying to set up things in my apartment where my little recording studio will be. So in my apartment now is a home. It's a home gym. It's a recording studio. It's a home office. There's a lot going on here. A lot of pieces I need to move around. I have my little weight set and stuff. I just ordered a squat stand. So all I can ask is that eventually when they find my dead body pinned under a barbell, that please magnetize my hard drive. I just don't, they don't need to know what I've been looking at in those lonely, lonely moments.
Joe DeVito Comedy on Twitter. Dry Bar, the name of
Dry Bar's blown up. It's huge. The video on YouTube has 700,000 hits and 1.3 million on Facebook, and you can watch for free.
You can watch it for free by going to Dry Bar. Notice how I stumbled through that. It was the envy and the jealousy and the drybar.comedy/Joe D.
Or you can just go to YouTube and Dry Bar Comedy and look for my name.
Fantastic. Thank you, Joe.
David, hello. Hello.
Hello.
Could I answer a question that David brought up?
Yes, Dr. Philip Hirschenfeld, yes.
But before you do that, Joe, how you doing?
Hey, what's going on?
Hey, this is my dad, Phil. He's seen you perform also.
Oh, right on. Okay. I see it.
You're a good guy.
Thank you.
The question is not, what's the risk? There's always risk. The question is, how much added risk am I willing to assume in order to do whatever the thing is? Getting out of bed in the morning is a risk. Although staying in bed all day is also a risk because you get a pulmonary embolism. So that's the question you have to ask. Is the restaurant going to be that worth it that I'm going to add 3.7% risk to my life, or the gym, or the whatever? If you think you've got an appendicitis, yeah, you're going to take a whole lot more risk to get that looked at.
Yeah, you're right. And I think we see it with people who we're all deciding what we consider acceptable risk, where you'll see some people wear a mask in some situations, but they'll wear it at half mast if they go somewhere else.
Right.
Very strange. But, you know, we all do this kind of calculations. Yeah. All I can say is that if you're thinking of coming to see anywhere I'm performing, you must be willing to take that risk. If you're willing to be an audience member, you have to be willing to say, I'm prepared to sacrifice everything to see Joe DeVito.
Thank you, Joe.
Always.
Thanks.
Thank you.
See you guys. Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.